That Pretty Girl in the Army by Henry Lawson. Dramatis Personae.
Sister Hannah.
Jack Moonlight, Bushman and Shearer's Rep. Read by Thomas Peter.
Billy Woods. Read by Jim Locke.
Jake Borum. Read by Larry Wilson.
Reformed Drunkard. Read by Wayne Cook.
Bob Brothers. Read by Algie Pug.
Mitchell. Read by Alan Mapstone.
Donald MacDonald. Read by Michelle Eaton.
One-Eyed Bogan. Read by Lorda.
Female Testifier. Read by Lauren Emma.
Plunderer. Read by Therese Lindholm.
The Black Testifier. Read by Wayne Cook.
Heckler. Read by Todd.
Narrator. Read by Kristen Hand. Now I often sit at Waddy's when the night is very near, with a head that's full of jingles and the fumes of bottled beer. For I always have a fancy, if I am over there, when the army prays for Waddy, I'm included in the prayer. It would take a lot of praying, lots of thumping on the drum, to prepare our sinful, straying, erring souls for kingdom come. But I love my fellow sinners, and I hope, upon the whole, that the army gets a hearing when it prays for Waddy's soul. When the World Was Wide. The Salvation Army does good business in some of the outback towns of the great pastoral wastes of Australia. There's the thoughtless, careless generosity of the bushman, whose pockets don't go far enough down his trousers. That's what's the matter with him. And who contributes to anything that comes along without troubling to ask questions. Like Long Bob Brothers of Burke, who, chancing to be a Protestant by rights, unwittingly subscribed towards the erection of a new Catholic church, and being chaffed for his mistake, said,
"Ah, well, I don't suppose it'll matter a hang in the end, any way it goes. I ain't got nothing against Roman Catholics."
There's the shearer, fresh with his check from a cutout shed, gloriously drunk and happy, in love with all the world, and ready to subscribe towards any creed and shout for all hands, including old Nick if he happened to come along. There's the shearer, half drunk and inclined to be nasty, who's got the wrong end of all things with a tight grip, and who flings a shilling in the face of outback conventionality, as he thinks, by chucking a bob into the Salvation Army ring. Then he glares round to see if he can catch anybody winking behind his back. There's the cynical joker, a queer mixture who contributes generously and tempts the reformed boozer afterwards. There's the severe-faced old station hand, in clean shirt and neckerchief and white moleskins, in for his annual or semi-annual spree, who contributes on principle and then drinks religiously until his check is gone and the horrors are come. There's the shearer, feeling mighty bad after a spree and in danger of seeing things when he tries to go to sleep. He has dropped 10 or 20 pounds over bar counters and at cards, and now he chucks a repentant shilling into the ring, with a very private and rather vague sort of feeling that something might come of it. There's the stout, contented, good-natured publican who tips the army as if it were a barrel organ. And there are others and other reasons, black sheep and ne'er-do-wells, and faint echoes of other times in Salvation Army tunes. Burke, the metropolis of the Great Scrubs, on the banks of the Darling River, about 500 miles from Sydney, was suffering from a long drought when I was there in 92, and the heat may or may not have been another cause contributing to the success, from a business point of view, of the Burke garrison. There was much beer boozing, and besides, it was vaguely understood, as most things are vaguely understood out there in the drought haze, that the place the army came to save us from was hotter than Burke. We didn't hanker to go to a hotter place than Burke, but that year there was an extraordinary reason for the army's great financial success there. She was a little girl, 19 or 20, I should judge, the prettiest girl I ever saw in the army, and one of the prettiest I've ever seen out of it. She had the features of an angel, but her expression was wonderfully human, sweet and sympathetic. Her big gray eyes were sad with sympathy for sufferers and sinners, and her poke bonnet was full of bunchy red-gold hair. Her first appearance was somewhat dramatic. Perhaps the army arranged it so. The army used to pray and thump the drum and sing and take up collections every evening outside Wadi Bothway's hotel, the Carrier's Arms. They performed longer and more often outside Wadi's than any other pub in town. Perhaps because Wadi was considered the most hopeless publican and his customers the hardest crowd of boozers in Burke. The band generally began to play about dusk. Wadi would lean back comfortably in a basket easy chair on his wide veranda and clasp his hands in a calm, contented way, while the army banged the drum and got steam up, and whilst perhaps there was a barney going on in the bar or a bloodthirsty fight in the backyard. On such occasions, there was something like an indulgent or fatherly expression on his fat and usually emotionless face. And by, he'd move his head gently and doze. The banging and the singing seemed to soothe him, and the praying, which was often very personal, never seemed to disturb him in the least. Well, it was about dusk one day. It had been a terrible day, 100-something startling in the shade, but there came a breeze after sunset. There had been several dozen of buckets of water thrown on the veranda floor and the ground outside. Wadi was seated in his accustomed place when the army arrived. There was no barney in the bar because there was a fight in the backyard, and that claimed the attention of all the customers. The army prayed for Wadi and his clients. Then a reformed drunkard started to testify against publicans and all their works. Wadi settled himself comfortably, folded his hands, and leaned back and dozed. The fight was over, and the chaps began to drop round to the bar. The man who was saved waved his arms and danced around and howled.
"Yes!"
he shouted hoarsely.
"The publicans and the boozers and the gamblers and sinners might think that Buck is hot, but hell is 1,000 times hotter, I tell you."
"Oh, Lord,"
said Mitchell, the shearer, and he threw a penny into the ring.
"Yes, I tell you that hell is 1,000,000 times hotter than Burke, I tell you."
"Hi, look here,"
said a voice from the background.
"That won't wash. Why, don't you know that when the Burke people die, they send back for their blankets?"
The saved brother glared round.
"I hear a free thinker speaking, my friends,"
he said. Then, with sudden inspiration and renewed energy,
"I hear the voice of a free thinker. Show me the face of a free thinker,"
he yelled, glaring round like a hunted, hungry man.
"Show me the face of a free thinker, and I'll tell you what he is."
Wadi hitched himself into a more comfortable position and clasped his hands on his knee and closed his eyes again.
"Yes,"
shrieked the brand.
"I'll tell you, my friends, I can tell a free thinker by his face. Show me the face of a..."
At this point, there was an interruption. One-eyed, or wall-eyed, Bogan, who had a broken nose, and the best side of whose face was reckoned the ugliest and most sinister, One-eyed Bogan thrust his face forward from the ring of darkness into the torchlight of salvation. He had got the worst of a drawn battle. His nose and mouth were bleeding, and his good eye was damaged.
"Look at my face,"
he snarled with dangerous earnestness.
"Look at my face. That's the face of a three-thinker, and I don't care who knows it. Now, what have you got to say against my face, man without a shirt?"
The brother drew back. He had been known in the Northwest in his sinful days as Man Without a Shirt, alias Shirty, or the Dirty Man, and was flabbergasted at being recognized in speech. Also, he had been in a shearing shed and in a shanty orgy with One-Eyed Bogan and knew the man. Now, most of the chaps respected the army, and indeed anything that looked like religion, but the Bogan's face, as representing free thought, was a bit too sudden for them. There were sounds on the opposite side of the ring, as from men being smitten repeatedly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.